ग्रंथो अयम वा आत्मा वृत्तमनुद्य अत्र अविद्वान इति उक्तम अप टू दैट पॉइंट देन आकांक्षा पूर्वकम तात्पर्यमाह द तात्पर्य ऑफ द इंपोर्ट ऑफ द नेक्स्ट द पैसेज इज गिवन बाय आकांक्षा विद विद अ क्वेश्चन सो सेज भाष्य द नेक्स्ट वन कानि पुनस्तानि कर्माणि यत् कर्तव्यतया पशुवत् परतंत्रो भवति एवाते देवादयः येषां कर्मभिः पशुवत् उपकरोति इति तदुभयं प्रपञ्चयति आकांक्षा कानि पुनस्तानि कर्माणि व्हाट आर दोज एक्शंस अगेन यत् कर्तव्यतया पशुवत् परतंत्रो भवति What again are those actions which this person feels that he must do because of which he finds himself paratantra dictated by the devatas like an animal is dictated by the master. So how does he find himself in a position of being dictated by the devatas? So what are those karmas which he looks upon as kartavya? It is not karma that really binds me, it is kartavya, the sense that I should do, a sense of obligation is what binds me. Where is a karmana badhyade jantu, a person is bound by karma, not really by karma, but by kartavya. Kartavya is a sense of duty that I have. That is what binds me with karma. There are millions of karmas everywhere in the world. I am not necessarily bound to them. The specific set of karmas I am bound to because I have in them a sense of kartavya or a sense of obligation. That I must do that. So that is why it is said, kāni punastāni karmāni. What are those karmas again? Yat kartavyataya pashuvat paratantaro bhavati. So what are those karmas in which this person has the kartavya buddhi that I must do this, because of which he becomes paratantraha. He becomes dictated by the devatas, like an animal is dictated by the master. Kevāte devādayaha. And who are these devatas and others who dictate him? So this fellow is dictated, all right. What are those actions because of which he is dictated? And who are those factors which dictate him? Devatas are not the only ones. Devatas are there, Pitrus are there, and Rishis are there, and many others are there by whom this person is dictated. Kevate devadeha yesham karma mihi pashut upakaroti di. So who are those to whom upakaroti? He becomes helpful, he serves. Like an animal serves the master, so also who are those devatas and others whom this person serves like an animal serves the master? So whom he serves by his own action? Yesham karma bihi pashuvat upakarodi iti. So this is akanksha. These two questions are there. So the question is, what are those actions in whom which this person is kartavya buddhi because of which he becomes paratantra? And who are all those who actually dictate him? Having created in him, because finding in him the kartavya buddhi, who are those who take advantage of it? Now that I have landed myself as being dictated by others, who are those fellows who jump, plunge into it and dictate me? And so that also we should know. Iti, so this akanksha being there, tat ubhayam prapanchayati. The next kandika explains this in detail, both of these. In great detail, the next kandika explains. So what are the karmas and what are those who dictate him? So we read the next mantra. Atho ayam va atma sarvesham bhutanam lokah sayajjhode yadyajate tena devanam lokah asayadanubhrute तेन ऋषीणाम् असयत् पितृभ्यो निप्रणाते यत् प्रजामिच्छते तेन पितॄणाम् असयन् मनुष्यान् वासयते यदेभ्यौषणम् ददाति तेन मनुष्याणाम् असयत् पशुभ्यस्तृणोदकम् विन्दते तेन पशूनां इदस्य गृहेषु स्वापदाः स्वयांसि आपिपीलिकाभ्यः उपजीवन्ति तेन तेषां लोकः यथा हवै स्वायलोकाय अरिष्टिमिच्छे एव एवह एवं विदे सर्वाणि भूतानि अरिष्टिमिच्छन्ति तद्वा एतद्विदितम् मीमांसितम्। असो अयम वा आत्मा, आत्मा इज ओनली जीवा। दिस फेलो, दिस पर्सन हु इज आइडेंटिफाइड विद हिज उपाधि, देयरफॉर लुक्स अपॉन हिमसेल्फ एज, सो दिस वर्णाश्रमादि अभिमान है। दिस पर्सन आइडेंटिफाइड विद वर्ण एंड आश्रम, दैट इज रिफर्ड टू बाय द वर्ड आत्मा हियर। सर्वेषां भूतानां लोकः, ही लोक इज भोग्य है, ही इज ऑब्जेक्ट ऑफ एंजॉयमेंट फॉर द होल वर्ल्ड, फॉर सर्वेषां लोकानां ऑफ द होल वर्ल्ड। दिस पर्सन हु दस हैज एन आइडेंटिफिकेशन अबाउट हिमसेल्फ बिकम्स लोकः, भोग्य विषय है, एन ऑब्जेक्ट ऑफ एंजॉयमेंट फॉर द एंटायर वर्ल्ड। तो व्हाट आर दोज लोकास? सज्जोति यज्जते, व्हाट एवर एक्ट ऑफ वर्शिप ही परफॉर्म्स और व्हाट एवर ऑब्लेशन ही गिव्स, तेन देवानाम लोको भवति। बिकॉज ऑफ दैट, बिकॉज ऑफ द एक्ट ऑफ वर्शिप और बिकॉज ऑफ द एक्ट ऑफ ऑफरिंग, ही बिकम्स ही भोग्य, ही बिकम्स द ऑब्जेक्ट ऑफ एंजॉयमेंट फॉर द देवतास। यदनुब्रूते तेन ऋषीणाम, दैट रिपीट्स द वेदास, बिकॉज ऑफ दैट बिकम्स ही भोग्य विषय, ऑब्जेक्ट ऑफ एंजॉयमेंट फॉर द ऋषीज। असत पितृभ्यो निर्गुणादि यत् प्रजामिच्छते तेन पितृणाम, दैट ही गिव्स, सो ही मेक्स ऑफरिंग्स टू पितृज और एंसेस्टर्स, मीन्स यत् प्रजामिच्छते, दैट ही डिजायर्स टू हैव प्रोजनी तेन, एंड हैज प्रोजनी, नॉट ओनली डिजायर्स बट दैट ही हैज प्रोजनी तेन पितृणाम, बाय दैट ही बिकम्स ही भोग्य विषय, ही बिकम्स द ऑब्जेक्ट ऑफ एंजॉयमेंट फॉर द मेन्स ऑफ पितृज और एंसेस्टर्स। असयन मनुष्यान वासयते यत् एभ्यः शरणं ददाति, that it gives shelter to other human beings and gives food to them, in manushyanam, by that it becomes the object of enjoyment to all the human beings. Athet pashubhya tranodakam vindati tena pashunam, and then it gives fodder and water, so grass and water to the animals or the cattle, by that it becomes the bhogya vishaya, the object of enjoyment to all the animals. Yadasya graheshu shvapadaha vayamsi apivinikabhya upajivanti, and that is home also, shvapadaha, all these cats and dogs, etc., this kind of animals, and vayamsi, and also birds, apivilikabhya, and all little creatures, insects, beginning from ants, etc., upajivandi, all of them are sustained in his home, because of he has a home, then all these fellows get sustained automatically. Everybody finds something, including mosquitoes will find him also as a bhogya, right away, you know, and so upajivandi, all of these sustain themselves. Tena tesham lokaha, that is how he becomes an object of enjoyment for all these creatures. Yathahavai swaya lokaya arishtim ichchet, so just as one desires safety, arishtim, safety for one's own body, swaya lokaya ichchedeva, just as one definitely desires safety for one's own body, protecting one's own body from hurt or damage, evam vire sarvani bhutani arishtim ichchandi. So how everybody wants to protect his body? Why? Because body protects him. So we want to protect that which protects us. As I say, dharma rakshate rakshitaha. Dharma, when protected, protects us. So since body protects me, therefore it's called kshetram. So kshatatrana, because the body actually protects me from all injury, etc., therefore it's called kshetram. So inasmuch as the body protects me, therefore I protect it. Similarly also, this man protects everybody, therefore they seek to protect him, like they seek to protect their own body. Yathahavai swaya lokaya arishtimichchet, just as anybody desires to protect his body, meaning may protect it from an injury, evaha evam vire sarvani bhutani arishtimichchandi, that's the reason why all these beings of the world desire that he should be protected. So all the rishis, all the pitrus, all the devatas, and all the human beings in need, and all these creatures and insects, all of them desire that he should be safe. Because he is their protector, or he is their nourisher, he is their supporter. That's how, that is what we call this bondage of duty, that I am duty bound. The duty binds me, because I am upakritah. I am actually the one who receives the privileges from them, and therefore it becomes my duty to return those privileges in the form of my actions. Tadva etat viditam. This is already known in the scriptures, not that this is being done off the top of one's head, but then etat viditam, this is what we learn from the Shastra, Mimamsitam, and then this has been analyzed, and so the wise people or the learned people have arrived at the conclusions and based on which this man actually conducts himself in this manner. So this also tells us how one should conduct oneself. Because this kartavya, the duty, as we said earlier, is really a means for one's own growth. It is not really to shackle, although it makes me partantra or dictated. So dharmena niyamyamanaha, even though he is as though dictated by dharma. But in the beginning the dictation is necessary in order to enable this person to grow. So that is how all of these enable me to grow in my personality. Just as a sculptor actually subjects this rock to all kinds of crude treatment, only to bring out that beauty that is inherent in that rock. And so also the whole idea of beauty is to bring out that inherent beauty in this person. And what are the ugliness that are removed? Just as all the unnecessary or the ugly part of the rock is removed, and so also the ugly part in my own self. And what are those things? All the natural tendencies which make me extrovert. And that therefore deprive me of the beauty of my own self. as long as my mind is focused outward, so long it will fail to appreciate its own self. And therefore, the first step that is necessary before this person can discover the beauty of himself or herself, what is first necessary is to direct his attention to the self. And today, on account of the fascination and attraction that the objects and the achievements create for him, his mind is directed outwardly. So how to actually direct his mind to the self? That is exactly what the kartavya does. So every time you have to perform the kartavya, every time you have to perform the duty, it will become necessary to overcome some temptation, some comfort, some laziness I must overcome, or tamas I must overcome, or some temptation I must overcome, rajas I must overcome. So dharma will require me to overcome tamas and rajas both. By rajas we mean bhoga buddhi, that has to be overcome, because as long as bhoga buddhi is there, the duty is not possible. Bhogi cannot be yogi. So duty makes me a yogi. And that yoga is possible only when I withdraw my preoccupation with bhoga. And of course, yoga is not possible for a person who is lazy or inactive, and therefore that also must be given up. How this duty actually enables one to grow out of tamas and rajas, and slowly and slowly bring him to sattva. Sattva means introvertedness or abiding in one's own self. Therefore Lord Krishna said, Yattadagre vishamiva pariname amrutopamam. This whole business of duty is like poison in the beginning, very bitter. Because I have to actually control, I have to control my extrovert tendencies. Keep them under check. Like we control the river flow by a dam and keep that flow under check, so that we can utilize that water for productive purposes. And so also my energies, which are presently being just squandered away in all these superfluous extrovert activities, all of that energy needs to be, first of all, conserved and then channelized. And that's exactly what kartavya or dharma does. So dharma is also translated as duty. So really what is my duty is translated as my day-to-day obligatory duties. And so for a person to follow dharma, all that the person has to do is to follow the daily and incidental obligatory duties. So nitya naimittika karma. If I follow that, I am following my dharma. So that dharma actually etat vijitam, etat nimamsitam. All of these has been thought about and all of these have been well analyzed. And then alone we have come to this conclusion that these yajñas or these dharma, these kartavyas or duties, I must follow. Okay, going back to page 317. Says Anandagiri, apipariyayasya aso shabdasya asangatim asankya vyakaroti. Aso idi. So aso means apipariyayasya. Generally, it seems that the word aso should mean api. Aso shabdasya asangatim. Where does this aso, word aso, does not seem to fit into this particular sentence? Asangatim asankya. Doesn't seem to have any anvaya, or does not seem to have any connection with this in this particular sentence. Iti asankya matva. Asankya means matva. Thinking that a word aso does not actually fit into this sentence, vyakaroti. Bhashyakara explains the place of the word aso. Says here, aso iti ayam vakyopanyasartha. Aso iti, this word aso, vākyopanyāsārthaḥ. Says footnote number 4. No, where are we? Footnote number 4. Agnyasya paśupārdhantre vākyapradaśanārthaḥ. Okay. So, vākyopanyāsārthaḥ. It is actually to introduce the vākya. Upanyāsa, to present the next passage. Because the subject matter is somewhat changed. We are talking about all these ātmānameva lokamupāsita, and so person is in a different mood. And all of a sudden now we bring him down to a different topic. Never atho. So again, arrest his attention that now there is a change of subject matter. So vakya, what is the vakya? Agnyasya pashupardantre. The next vakya says how an ignorant person is dictated by, like an animal, by all these various elements of the creation. So that is the purpose of that vakya. And in order to introduce that vakya, the word atho has been employed. It doesn't mean api, it just means only atha actually, thereafter. Or it is the upanyasa, the beginning of the next vakya. Okay, then continuing the bhashya. Ayam yah prakrito grihi karmadikrataha avidvan sharirendriya sanghada vishishtaha pindaha atma iti uchyate. Ayam vai atma. What is atma? What's the meaning of atma here? It's not Satchidananda atma. It is this ignorant self. So Vashyakara, ayam. Ayam is what? Yaha prakrutaha gruhi. Prakrutaha vichara vishaya. So connect back to the earlier passages. In between the passage came, that passage has to be sort of set aside, put aside, and connect with what is under discussion. Prakrutaha grihi. Prakrutaha vichara vishaya. What we are talking about is ignorant person. Grihi. Grihi means gruhastaha. Aham iti abhimani. This person who has identification about oneself, that I am a gruhastaha, I am brahmana, who, whatever. So grihi. Karma adhikrataha. And only on account of that identification that is obliged to perform the karma. The day he becomes free from that identification, no more a grihi. Nobody is born grihi. There is no stamp here that I am a gruhi, or I am a husband, or I am a wife. No stamp. So Vaswami says, talking about this man always dictates his wife, you know. And so he always treats him as a servant and things like that. And so he gets excited, Swami. He says, what is it? He says, you know, idiot. She's a woman. So she's not just wife, she's a woman primarily. In a given role, she's wife. But basically, she's a woman, you know. And therefore, when we don't respect that, and we think that this person is nothing but wife, that's all that she has to do is to keep on performing the duties and serving. And that is how this kind of relationship is there. So we have to forget that that person is wife only when she is abhimana about wife, that's all. And then, otherwise she is not wife, and vice versa, you know. Husbands also have plight like that sometimes, you know. So it's not the only wives are dictated, husbands can also be dictated anyway. But regardless of that, so only when this person is abhimanam that I'm husband, then alone he's available for dictating. So that's why what happens is, sometimes when he goes to work, now there he is a manager, you know, And now this woman goes there and starts saying that you bring vegetables, you forget it. When I come home, then you talk to me. Not here. Or sometimes he says, you are not supposed to come to my office, you know. Even telephone calls he does not accept. Because the phone also he talks like that. And then he is not willing to be dictated like that. And therefore, he says, I am husband when I come home, that's all. And the moment there is a telephone call from his wife, he is not accepted, or the secretary answers that call. Here I am a manager, whoever I am my own identification here. Husband I am when I am at home, that's all. Or a wife also. So, wife I am when I am at home. But not Arjuna also. His Arjuna when in palace, not in the battlefield. That was his problem. He forgot that he was in battlefield. He thought that he was still in the palace, home. Lord Krishna says, you are not in home, you are in the battlefield. So the rules of game are different. So rules of game are different. Home, in the office, in the battlefield, in the sports field, everywhere rules of game are different, and therefore you relate with them differently. Your professor, you treat differently in the college. When you are playing cricket game 11 with them, then the rules of game are different. And so, anyway, so grihi means what? Grihastoham iti abhimani. Moment he becomes free from abhimana, by recognizing that I am not this upadhi, that's why he is no more a grihastha. And he does not anymore have any kartavya also. Kartavya, or the sense of duty, always accompanies a certain sense of identification, abhimana. So, prakrutaha grihi karma adhikrutaha, teva adhikrutaha. Adhikrutaha means obliged, really. Obliged to perform karma, that's what it simply means. Karma adhikrutaha, one who is obliged to perform. Actually, adhikrita means adhikari. One who is karma yogya, meaning one who is now qualified to perform action. But qualification automatically means also obligation. One who is obliged to perform the action because he looks upon it as with certain abhimanam and so is qualified. Who can he be? A vidwa, naturally. An ignorant person who takes the upadhi to himself. Sharirendriya sanghata vishishtaha. And so identified with sharirendriya sanghata. Identified with the Sanghata, with this physio-physico-psycho complex consisting of Sharira, Indriya, Manaha and all of these complex. Tat Tadatma Adhyasi, meaning one who is identified with this as a self. Pindaha, Pinda with Sanghataha. So one identified with this Pinda, actually body is called Atma here. Body is Pinda, meaning the physio-physico-psycho complex is referred to as Atma here. But then this person who is identified as the Pinda also is Atma. So it is this Sharirendriya Sanghata Vishishta Pindaha. This Pinda or this assembly here, which consists of the body, sense organs, mind and whatever, that is Atma here, because we call the body as Atma. But here the word Atma therefore means the one identified with this body. Atma iti uchyate in this particular khandika. So what is meant by the word Atma is the one who is identified with this physico-psycho-complex. So Anandagiri said, parasyabhi prakrutatvat tato vishinasti grahiti. Swayam prakrutaha, the subject and discussion. For both are under discussion, Jivatma and Paramatma, both were mentioned in the last passage. So he says, no, we do not mean para or Paramatma. Parasyabhi prakritatvad, in as much as Paramatma also is under discussion, tataha vishinasti, here specifies that not Paramatma but Jiva, the grihi is what is meant. Grihitva hetu avidvan ityadhi, so avidvan, sarirendriya sanghata vishishta pindatma. So that is the explanation of, so the reasons why he is called grihi. How can Atma be called grihi? Sachidananda Atma is called Gruhi, when? Only when that Atma is identified with this Sanghata. Itara Paryudasartham Karma Adhikrata Hiti Uktam. Itara Paryudasartham, footnote number 5. Itara Vidwan. So Paryudasartham, to exclude that Vidwan, so Karma Adhikrata Hiti Uktam. What happens is, now even in the human being also, there can be wise man. An ignorant person. So avidvan, sarirendriya, so karma adhikrutaha. There could be a person actually entertaining this body, sporting this body, put it this way. So there could be a person sporting the body and still may not be called Grihi because he is not identified with the Sanghata and therefore he is not karma adhikrata, not qualified or obliged to perform karma. So therefore Vachaka said Grihi because avidwan and therefore karma adhikrata. So itara parivadasasam karma adhikrata hai yuktam, in order to exclude parivadasam, excluding, in order to exclude the paramatma, here it is said karma adhikrata hai, one who is adhikrata hai, qualified to perform the karma. Then Anandagiri says now katam uktasya atmana hai sarva bhogyata. Look at this, paramatma becomes bhogya vishaya. Katam uktasya atmana, how the atma thus identified with sanghata sarvasya bhogyata. Or how does he become bhogya? How does he become an object of enjoyment to all these people? Iti asankyaha sarvesham iti. So that asankya is replied now, sarvesham, says in Bhashya. Sarvesham devadinam pipilikantanam bhutanam lokaha bhogyaha Atma ityartha sarvesham varnashramadivhitaihi karma bihi upakaritvat. So ayam atma sarvesham bhutanam lokaha. That is first explained. Sarvesham devadyanam, beginning from devatas all the way up to apipipilikantanam, beginning from devatas all the way up to the ends of all these creatures. Bhutanam lokaha bhogyaha, he becomes an object of enjoyment to all these elements, beginning from devatas all the way up to the ends, is atma. Then the question comes, Anandagiri's question then comes, katam uktasya atmana sarva bhogyata, how can atma become the bhogya, the object of enjoyment for all this? Then next says, second sarvesham varanashramadivihitahi karma bhi upakaritvat, because he becomes an upakari, he becomes helpful, he becomes actually helpful to all of them, he serves the purpose of all of them by what? Karma bhi, he serves the purpose of all these elements of the creation by his karma. What kind of karma? Varanashramadi vihitahi karma bhi, by performing the karma which are enjoined upon him based on his varna and the ashrama, by performance of those karma, he serves the purpose of all these various elements in the creation, and that is how he becomes their object of enjoyment. That is how he becomes as though dictated by them. Tadeva prasna dvara prakatayate. That very same thing now is brought out here by prasna, by the question by Bhashyakara. Kaif punaha iti, says Bhashya. Kaif punaha karma visheshaihi upakuruvan kesham bhuta visheshanam loka iti uchyate. Kaihi punaha karma visheshaihi upakuruvan. Alright, you are saying that on account of performance of the karmas or duties that are enjoined upon him, he serves the purpose of all these elements. What are those duties? Kaihi punaha karma visheshaihi. What are those specific karmas or actions by performed upakurma, by performance of which he serves the purpose of all these elements of the nature? And kesham bhuta visheshanam lokaha. And what are those specific living beings? So what are those specific actions by performance of which, and what are those specific living beings of which he becomes the, he serves the purpose? Iti uchyate, that is being said now. Sa iti, that is what the Upanishad says. Sa yajjahodi yad yajade tena devanam lokaha. So saha yajjahodi yad yajade tena devanam lokaha. That's the next passage. How he becomes the bhogya vishaya for the devatas? So Bhashyakara explains. Sagrihi yajjahode yadyajate yago yagah devatam uddishya svatva parityagah saiva asechanavadhikah. होमः तेन होमयागलक्षणेन कर्मणा अवश्यकर्तव्यत्वेन देवानां पशुवत्परतन्त्रत्वेन प्रतिबद्धः इति लोकः. Saha, that's what the Shruti says. Saha means Grihi, this one identified with having this identification with Varna and Ashrama. Therefore, who is called Grihi, a Grihastha, yad Grihastoham iti Abhimanivan, yad Jyoti, yad Yajate. So says Anandagiri here, Yajate Jyotyoho Tyagarsatvena Avisheshat Punaruktimashinkya. So Yajate, Yajate means what? Perform the worship. Juhodi meaning makes offerings or oblations. So yaga and homa, yajati, that root is yaj, from which comes the word yaga. Juhodi, from that the word comes homa. And so yaga and homa, what is the difference between them? So yajati juhotyoho yaga tattvena avisheshat. When you perform a yaga or when you perform a homa, in both of them tyaga, some kind of a tyaga, meaning some kind of a giving is always involved. Some offering rather. So some offering is always involved whether you perform yaga or you perform homa. So tyaga tattvena avisheshat. So both the dhatus always, both dhatus have actually, have the meaning of offering is involved in both of them. Punaruktim asankhya. So when the Upanishad says yad jahodi yad yajate, it looks like it is the same, Jyoti and Yajate mean the same thing. Then why these two expressions are used if they mean the same? In the Asankhya. Yajati Chodana Dravya Devata Kriya Samudaye Krutarsatvadi Dinyayanaha. So, in the Pura Mimamsa, in the fourth chapter, there are these two sutras that are referred to here. Yajati Chodana Dravya Devata Kriya Samudaye Krudarsatvadi Dinyayana. Nyaya means that sutra is there. In the Pura Mimamsa. See footnote number 6. Yajati Ityadi. Jaimini Sutra 4-27. Yajati Chodana. So that is sutra. Yajati Chodana Dravya Devata Kriya Samudaye Krudarsatvadi. That is the sutra. In the inverted comma. And the Tika explains that sutra. Yajati Chodana. Chodana means direction. Here is Shabda. Yajati Shabda. Dravya Devata Kriya Samudaye. So, Dravya Devata and Kriya Samudaye. Samudaye means a group which consists of Dravya Devata and Kriya. Dravya is the various materials of worship. Devata is the one to whom these worship or materials are offered. And Kriya is the act of offering. So, therefore, this yaj dhatu involves all of this. Yaj means to worship. And worship involves the dravya, devata and kriya. It involves the materials of offering. It involves the devata also to whom these materials are offered. And also the very kriya or the act of offering, all of these are involved, are included in the meaning of the root yaj, means to worship. So the Tika says, yajadi chodana, yajadi shabdha, Dravyadi samudaye vartate. Dravyadi means what? Dravya devata kriya samudaye vartate. That's what it means. So yajati chodana dravya devata kriya samudaye vartate. That's what the sutra means. That word yaj, I mean that the root yaj, involves and includes in the meaning, the scope of its meaning, all this dravya, devata and the kriya. Meaning what? Tadvachi ityartha. That's the meaning of the word, meaning of the root yaj. Then krutasattva, that's the sutra says. Why is it so? How come the word yaj means this? Nyaya means you must always give reasoning. Every sutra, when it is nyaya, it makes a pratignya and then gives a reason for it. So pratignya is what? Yajati chodana, meaning the word yajati, meaning the root yaj. Dravya devata kriya samudaye vartate. Or the word yaj tadvati is the meaning of the word yaj. Why is it so? That's the prasignya. Why? Kṛtārthatvā, the reason. So the Tika explains, Kṛtārthatvāt tatra nairākāṅkṣyāt. So there is no akāṅkṣa. So when you include all of these, no akāṅkṣa remains. meaning that the action of worship can be completed only when all these three are involved. Otherwise, if all these three are not involved, the yajna root only means a certain act of offering. Then the akanksha will remain, what is to be offered? And suppose you include that, then also akanksha and expectancy will remain. To whom is it to be offered? Therefore, that act of offering can be successfully completed only when you include in that act the materials of offering and the devatas to whom they are offered. Sukritasattvat. Tatra nairakanksyat. Tavadupyeva charitasattvat ityadha. And only when the root yaj, meaning means this, then no further akanksha remains, and therefore the world has fulfilled its purpose when these meanings are included, and the world would not fulfill the purpose if all these are not included. Therefore, the sutra says that in the word yaj, in the root yaj, the meaning of the root yaj should include dravya, devata and kriya. So yaga rather. So word yaga should include dravya, devata and kriya. Then the tika continues. Yajati dadati jihoditi shruta yagadinam bhedahasti navayati samshe. So sometimes we find the Vedas yajati, meaning worships. Juho dadati, gives. Juhoti, offers. See, worships, gives and offers. Shruta yagadinam bhedahasti nava. So do they, all of these mean different or do they mean the same? It is samshay. Tyagatmakatvena avisheshat bhedona. So Purupakshi there says, Tyagatmakatvena avisheshat bhedhanasti. Say there is no meaning, no difference in meaning in yajati, dadati, juhoti. Juhoti comes from the root ha. Ha means to give up. So juhoti gives up. So giving, offering, worshipping. Purupakshi says that all of these mean the same because all of them involve the tyaga. All of them involve some offering or the other, and therefore, inasmuch as offering is involved in the meaning of all these three, they should mean the same. And that is the Purupaksha and Puramimamsa. Ini prapte, that's how every adhikarana must take care of all these elements, you know. Then, devato deshena dravityagasya yagatvat. So then, what is the nirana in the Puramimamsa? Yes, when different words are used, there must be slight differences in their meaning. So yaga, homa and dana, there must be some difference in them. So what is yaga? Devatoddeshena dravyatyagasya yagatvat. So when you make an offering of some material to the devatas, that is called yaga. Tasyaiva prakshepadikasya homatvat. That is very dravya. How do you offer now? If that dravya is offered in fire, then that is called homa. So sometimes we perform worship, etc., where we offer naivedya and many things to the Lord, all of that will be called yaga, yajanam, worship. But when the offering is in the form of offering in fire, so you invoke the devata in the fire and make the offerings in the fire, then it will be called homa. Tasyeva prakshepadikasya homatvat. Then when is it called dana? Parasvikara pariyantasya dhanatvar. And when that dravya is accepted by somebody, then it is called dhanam. You might make an offering, all right, but it may not be accepted. So when that act of offering is concluded by seeing the acceptance on the part of somebody, then it is called dhanam. So, yaga, homa and dhana, all of them involved. You can see Puram Imams, you know. So how, what an amount of thinking is done on every word, because we say the Vedas are sabda pramanam. Vedas only convey by words. And therefore the meaning of the words as used by Veda, not as dictionary, other koshas, etc. So that is a niruktam. So the words as used by the Vedas are also there. So in what sense the Vedas use the given words, that must be understood. And Vedas themselves will reveal that in some way or the other, by use of that word elsewhere and so forth. That is how the Mimamsa is done. So teshamidi bheda teshamidi stilam purvatantre. This is how purvatantra means in Purvamimamsa, that this is the kind of difference between the yaga, homa and dana. This is what is determined in the purvatantra, meaning in Purvamimamsa. And we just borrow it from there. So Vashyakara borrows it. That's why now going back to Anandagiri, yajati chodana dravya devata kriya samudaya. సిక్స్ ఫుట్ నోట్ వచ్చాం ద్రవ్య ద్రవ్య దేవత క్రియాం ఇది పూర్వతంత్రే పాఠం దృష్టదే. సో ద్రవ్య దేవత క్రియాం ఐరన్ బట్ క్రియా సముదాయం ఆల్సో ఇస్ దేర్ వాట్ ఎవర్ కృతార్థత్వాది మత్వ ఇది న్యాయనా దట్ ఈస్ ది జైమిని సూత్ర 4-27. So based on that nyaya, based on that nirnaya that has been done in the Purva Tantra, Pura Mimamsa, Vashyakara says, Yagaha devatamuddhishya svatva parityagaha, Vashyakara says. Yagaha devatamuddhishya svatva parityagaha. Sva means dravya. So svatva parityagaha, dravya parityagaha, devatamuddhishya, just making an offering to the devata is called yaga. Saiva asechanavadika homaha. That very offering to the devatas when it concludes into offering in fire. Says asechanam prakshepaha. So when that dravya is offered such that it is offered in fire, then that is called homaha. So this is what a person performs. So worship to the devatas is performed in these two ways. It is not that worship is performed merely by Homa, but worship can be also performed by mantra and other things. And so, all the acts of puja, etc. we do, will be all categorized as yaga. And when we perform the fire worship, it will be called Homa. That's what a person does. Both the kinds of worships he does to the devatas. They worship the rivers also. They make offering in the river. Worship mountains, worship trees, worship all this. So make offerings, suitable offerings to them. Sometimes the very deities are invoked in fire and you make offering in the fire. Sometimes you make offering to the sun directly. Doing your sandhyavandanam and make an offering to the sun. So that time all that will be called yaga because it does not involve offering in the fire. Tena, tena means what? Homa yaga lakshanena karmana. So why the karma characterizes homa and the yaga? Avashyakartavyatvena, because you must necessarily, Anandagiri said as also further, uktamcha juhotihi asechanavadhika syadati. Uktamcha, again the next sutra in the Purva Mimamsa says sutra number 9, saduktaihi shravana juhotir asechanavadhika, in fact it should be syad, iti sutra vipiretyah uktamcha ityadhi. Avadi, so when that culminates into sechanam or praksheva, then it's called homa. So uktam juhotihi, yajatihi is what? Yajatihi is devata, uddesh, devata uddesha, svatva parityagaha. Juhotihi is asechana avadikaha. When that culminates into praksheva or offering the fire, then it's called juhoti. Anyway, tena homa yaga lakshanena karmana. Why this karma characterized by homa in the yaga? Avashyakartavyatvena, which must be definitely performed by this person because he is bound by duty to perform those actions because he has an identity that I am so and so. Devanam pashuvat partantratvena pratibaddhaiti lokaha. Never. He is partantra. Actually he is dictated by dharma. But indirectly he is dictated by devatas, you can say. Devatas dictate him through dharma. Devatas don't dictate him. But he lands himself in a condition of being dictated by dharma, because he has identification of, you know, with this body, etc. And that is how he is as though being dictated by the devatas, really. Nobody dictates him. He wants to be dictated, really. Person wants to be dictated. That's why, then, of course, then people are ready to dictate him. So dharma dictates him because he wants to be dictated. He feels that he is being protected, then he is dictated. When somebody commands me, then I feel that at least the command I will follow, all right. But I have the assurance that I am being looked after by that person. I am looked after, I am being protected. That's the reason why people want to be commanded. Not that they care to be commanded, but that being commanded gives them a sense of security. That one who commands also gives them a security of protection. Whether that person who commands actually protects them or exploits them is a different matter. But the thing is, people who are commanded, they allow themselves to be commanded because they feel that being commanded, he is being protected. They see some protection, that is psychology. So the slave psychology sees the protection in a certain command. Everybody has it. Every ignorant person will have it in one way or the other, one measure or the other. But anyway, that is how this person lends himself in the position of being dictated. Pashuvat partantratvena pratibaddhaiti. And so, iti evam prakarena lokaha tesham bhogyaha. In this manner, he becomes bhogyaha, the object of enjoyment for these devatas. अहरह तेन ऋषीणां लोकः अफेत् पितृभ्यो निपृणाति प्रयच्छति पिण्डोदकादि यच्च प्रजामिच्छते प्रजार्थमुद्यमं करोति इच्छा च उत्पत्ति उपलक्षणार्था प्रजां च उत्पादयति इत्यर्थः तेन कर्मणा अवश्यकर्तव्यत्वेन पितॄणां लोकः पितॄणां भोग्यत्वेन परतन्त्रो लोकः अतेत् अनुब्रूते अनुब्रूते मीन्स् हि रिपीट्स् So, Veda, Veda Anuch, what is it? Veda Manuchya, Anuch, meaning repeating. But teaching also, Anubhrute, Swadhyam, Adhide, that is repeats the Vedas. Aharaha, that every day repeats the Vedas as the obligated duty. It's one thing that I repeat the Vedas because I enjoy it or I want to do it. You might enjoy it also. But you feel that you're obliged to do, every day you must do this part. Veda means, these days you might want to repeat Vishnu Sahasranama and whatever it is. And that he does because he feels he has to do. That I'm a Vaishnava, therefore I must do that. That I'm a Jaina, so I must do that. And whatever identification I have about myself. And because of that I feel that I have to do a given thing. So, yat anubhrute swadhyayam adhite aharahah. Every day he repeats his swadhyaya, repeats the Vedas, repeats that paatha. Then Rushinam Lokaha, that is how the Rushis get satisfaction. So see, Rushis get satisfaction. That the Vedas that we have promulgated, Vedas that we have propagated, all of them are being retained, that's their satisfaction. Devatas are satisfied when they receive the oblation. Rushis are satisfied when whatever they were taught is continued and is, that tradition remains and the tradition also is spread. So when the prachara is done, the Rishis are satisfied that okay, our work is being continued. Rishis. So Pitrus are satisfied when their progeny continues, when the line continues. So person is satisfied as a father only when his name is added to the name of his son. And that son will be satisfied when his name is added to the grandson. Therefore, they always want to see the continuity of my lineage. They do not want that the lineage should be broken. They feel really, even today also, everywhere in the world, and so much so in India, people are pained when they don't have son. Or if they have son, if the son does not have son, then there is a pain. Because now there is nobody, because daughter goes to somebody's home and daughter's name is changed while the son retains my name. And so when only I only have daughter, or my son only has daughter, then also people push him. You must have son. You must have son. Has another daughter. Again push him. And that is how they wind up having several daughters, ultimately, hopefully he has a son, that's fine. Until then, that process must continue because there's a need to have son. So Pitrus are only satisfied when they find that their Pindodaka is all offered because for three generations the Pinda and the cakes, whatever you call them, and Udaka, all of that must be offered. So yet Pitrubhya Nipranati Prayachati Pindodakadi, that at the time of Shraddha he gives this Pinda. And that every Amavasya also, Tarpana is done, that time Udaka is given. So that he offers pinda, the cakes and water to the Pitrus. Not only that, yachya prajamicha. It's not enough that he alone does it. But he also must have children who should continue to do that. Sons who must continue to do that. Yet prajamicha, prajam means son actually here, Prajatam udyamam karodi. Ichchade means what? Udyamam karodi. He does whatever is required to have the son.
Why do you say that?
Ichchacha utpatti upalakshanartha.
We should not stop
at ichcha. It must actually culminate into having a son. So yat prajam ichchate, that he desires to have a son is not enough. That he has a son. So does whatever Uddhima is required. He must get married and things like that. All of that becomes duty. So parents see that it is a duty to get the son married. And parents feel in India at least that duty is incomplete when the children are not married. In the West they don't care. I mean, he will take care of himself, and if he wants to get married, well and good, otherwise. But here the parents will feel pain if their children are not married. And they will force their children to get married somehow. Many of them, even today. So, prajatam udyamam karodi icchate utpatti upalakshanartha. So, icchate, the Upanishad says, that icchate has iccha, desire. That desire also should be representative of utpatti, that actually that they have sons. Prajānta utpādayati ityardha. So prajām ichyada meaning what? Prajānta utpādayati. That these people also, that this person also gives birth to a son. That he makes offering of the cakes and the water to his ancestors, departed souls, and that he gives birth to a son. Oh, tena karmana. Then the pitrus are satisfied. Everybody has a different criteria for satisfaction. Then you must know how to satisfy whom. And so if you keep doing same thing to everybody, it may not work. You might be very sincere and doing it, but then it may not work. Ati jingi mein karu tuai na, but you must know what to do. You know, people do things for the whole of their life, that's not enough. They should know what to do. And so everybody has a particular taste. Everybody has particular likes and dislikes. So pitrus want certain, to be satisfied in a certain way. Devutas want to be satisfied in a certain way. Rishis want to be satisfied in some certain ways. So tena karmana avashya kartavyatvena pitrunam lokaha, pitrunam bhogyatvena paratantra lokaha. And therefore, tena karmana avashya kartavyatvena, he finds that, he believes, he feels that he must necessarily perform this karma of offering pinda and udakam and of giving birth to a son. All of that he considers necessary to do. And that is how pitrunam loka. Simply by having kartavya buddhi, the pitrus are happy. As long as kartavya buddhi is there, that will dictate this person. Nobody has to come and dictate me. All that they have to do is to plant in me a kartavya buddhi. That's what we should successfully do. If you want people to do things, that's all. All you have to do is to plant in them a sense of kartavya. Whichever organization is able to do that. Is able to do that, however, by creating in the people a sense of kartavya. In the olden days, you were able to do it merely by giving them salary and creating in them a sense of obligation that I am receiving salary and therefore I must do. But today it doesn't work that. People feel that salary they should receive and still they need not do things. Therefore some other means are required. Successful management will apply whatever means are required to create that sense of kartavya. If you cannot do that, people won't work. So today, just because I am employed and I am receiving the protection, I am receiving all the benefits and I am receiving the salary, that is not considered enough by a person to feel that he is obliged. That's all. No, that's the fact of life. However you criticize or whatever, that's how it is. Tamas means that. This is Kali Yuga, means tamoguna. Means that's that. So further things are required. You make them feel part of this. That's why partnership in all these cooperative systems and stuff like that, make them feel part of it. Make them feel that this is ours. Now in the olden days, just because the place of work was considered as my place, the work was considered my work. So only when a person can attach himself to the work, only when he feels that he is a part of it, then alone he will do. Because atmanastu kamaya saram priyam bhavati, ultimately anything is dear to me because atma is dear to me. The work will become dear to me when the work is somehow connected with me. When I can find a satisfaction in doing that work, then alone I will be motivated to do that. So formally I found a motivation to do because I thought that I must pay back in terms of my labor or my effort because I am being paid for it. But today in spite of receiving salary etc., people do not feel that they are obliged to do. They don't feel part of it. I go to bank all right, but I don't feel a part of it. I go to work all right, but I don't feel part of it. If I don't feel part of it, I'm not motivated to do really. Therefore, to make people feel part, this becomes a part of personnel management. How do you create in them a motivation? Of course,
Giving them benefits is a motivation. But that's why in the Western system they want to create a sense of competition, that sense of performance, and that is how we identify. I am identified with my work by way of performance, that I must be better than others. I must shine out, and that's how I have a sense of satisfaction. So I have satisfaction not because I do, but because I do it better than others. So that is how the motivation is created, by invoking from this person a sense of competition. But this is very destructive of the person. So ideally, and that's what these experiments are being made, where people are motivated by creating in a sense of belonging to this place, that I'm a part of this. So profit sharing and all these schemes are offered to make them part of it. So that whatever I do contributes partly to my own self, and that's why he's motivated to do more and more. Anyway, the idea is that avashya kartavyatvena. If I am identified that I am a son, then alone, and whatever putra means, then alone I will do those things. Today nobody does it. What is this shraddha and what is all that stuff? You know, that only means that we eat food, that's all. Nobody does any pinda and udaka and all this, nothing is done. Why? Because putra I am all right. But what putra means what? Pum nama naraka traya, there is a naraka called pum. And then I am a protector of my parents or my ancestors from that naraka. Therefore I am called putra. I don't know about naraka, I don't know about pitrus, I don't know who are there. I don't even know the name of my grandfather today. Grandfather at the most I may know, but who is the father of my grandfather, I don't know. So we are getting so disconnected with the thing that there is no sense of belonging at all. That is how when in me is created a sense of belonging, that I belong to this family, I belong to this ancestry, then alone I will have the motivation to offer something. When I belong, I am a Rishiputra, then alone I will do something to satisfy the Rishis. That I am connected with devatas, then alone I will do something to satisfy the devatas. So that avashya kartavyatvena, that's how you create in him this sense of duty, and that's how person is actually motivated and indirectly dictated also. Okay.
Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Shankaram Shankaracharyam Keshavam Bhadarayanam. Sutra Bhashya Kutau Vande Bhagavantau Punah Punah. Ishvaro Guru Ratmedi Murti Veda Vibhagine Vyoma Vajyaka Dehaya Dakshina Murtaye Namah. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namah. Hari Om. Ayam va atma sarvesham bhutanam lokah. Sayajjhoti yadyajate tena devanam lokah. Asayadanubhrute tena rishinam. Asayat pitrubhyo nipranate yat prajamichyate tena pitrinam. Asayan manushyan vasayate yadebhyo shanam dadate tena manushyanam. Asayat pashubhyastranodakam vindate tena pashunam. Idasya grahesha svapadavayamsi apipilikabhya upajivante. Tena desham lokah. Yathahavai svaya lokaya aristimicche. Evam haivam vide sarvani bhutani aristimicchante. Tadva
etat viditam, mimam sitam. Suru said, atra avidvan varanashramad abhimanah dharmenam niyamyamanah devadi karma kartavyataya pashuvat partantrahi devuktam. Said it was mainly in the 10th kandika as to how this person, and then subsequently during the creation of the varanashrama, how this avidvan or ignorant person, varanashramad abhimanah, having abhimanam, or this kind of identification that I belong to certain varana, I belong to certain ashrama, and therefore, dharmena niyamyamanah, on account of that, he naturally becomes obliged to perform the karma or the dharma associated with that varna and ashrama. That's how you can say that he becomes niyamyamanah, he becomes controlled by dharma, by the sense of duty. Meaning a sense of duty arises the moment I have a certain notion or identification about myself. Devadi karma kartavyataya pasuvat partantrahi devuktam said, yatha pasu, pashuhu evam sa devanam. Just as there is an animal for a human being, so also he becomes a pashu or an animal for the devatas, so devadinam. Even though that verse says devanam, it should be understood as devadinam. For devatas and others, he becomes like a pashu. Why is it so? Karma kartavyataya. Because he has a sense of kartavya, a sense of duty towards all of these. And that is how pashuvat partantrahi devuktam. So he is like, he is controlled by them, like an animal is controlled or ruled by the master. Kani purastani karmani yat kartavidaya pashuvat partantra bhavati. So what are those various karmas or duties by performance of which, or what are those actions in which he, in him arises there a sense of duty, that these actions I must perform. There can be countless actions among which are those actions in which that arises in him a sense of duty. Kevate devadeha yesham karma bihi pasud upakaroti. And who are those devatas and others for whom he becomes like an animal and whom he becomes upakaroti, becomes helpful, serves their purpose. So who are those whose purpose he serves like an animal may serve the purpose of his master. So this mantra is said to me in answer to this question. In short, this mantra actually describes here the fivefold yajnas. The pancha yajna are being described here. Brahma yajna, Deva yajna, Pitru yajna, Rushi yajna, and Dhru yajna, or Bhuta yajna. Brahma yajna means the yajna for Rushis, that is the Veda, recital of Vedas. Deva yajna is the worship of the Devatas. Pitru yajna is offering the, making offerings to the Pitrus or departed souls. Dhru yajna is giving food and shelter to the needy human beings. And Bhuta yajna is feeding the animals and creatures. That is how the five yajnas are being described in our scriptures, and those five yajnas are described here in this manner. Of which, Sayad Jihodi Yad Yajade Tena Devanam Lokaha Yad Jihodi Yad Yajade. That he performs Jihodi, performs the Homa, Yad Yajade, that he performs a Yaga. And yesterday we discussed the difference between Yaga and Homa and Dana. So merely offering of a dravya or a material worship is called yaga. And when that offering is in the form of offering in the fire, oblation in the fire, it is called homa. And then when offering culminates into receiving by someone else, that is when I give up the ownership of certain dravya, my ownership. And when I establish someone else's ownership, that is established, that is called dhanam. So although each one of these involves tyaga or giving up, but there is a difference in this tree that was explained yesterday. So tena huma yaga lakshanena karmana avasya kartavyatvena devanam pasuvat partantratvena pratibandhayati lokaha. The thief is obliged to perform the homa and the yaga. And that is how the devata's purpose is served. Therefore we can say that he is as though niyamya, as a control by the devata, or he is pashuvat pratibaddha, he is bound like an animal by the devatas. Yanu brute swadha madhite aharaha tena rushinam lokaha. That every day he recites the Vedas, every day he repeats the Vedas, that is how he serves the purpose of the rishis. Asayat pitrubhyo nipranadi prachadi pindodakadi. yet prajamichade. And that on the occasions he offers this, makes offers of pinda and udaka, the water and the cakes to the departed souls, also prajamichade. That he desires to have progeny, or that he proceeds to have progeny of the son, that is how he actually serves the purpose of pitrus, the departed souls. Now, page 319, continuing in the Bhashya, the fourth line. Athayan manushyan vasade bhumidakadidanena grahe yachatevbhya vasadbhya avasadbhyova artibhya asanam dadade tena manushyana atha yat pashubhya pranodakam vindade lambhayade tena pashuna yadasya griheshu swapadaha vayamsisha pipilikadibhi saha kana bali bhandakshalanade upajivande tena tesham lokah. Athayan manushyan vasayade, that he gives the shelter of the manushya, of human beings. How? Bhumi udakari danena grahe vasayade. So when someone visits his home, or when atithi, so when unannounced some guest comes there seeking shelter, then he receives them and gives them water and shelter. This is what he does. Yachatebhya vasadbhya avasadbhya arthibhya ashram dadadi. And he offers food to them. Food to those who are dwelling in his house or those who are not dwelling. So he gives food to those who are guests at his house or those who may just come for food, arthibhya. So those who are desirous of food, to them he offers food. Tena, not yena, but tena, manushyanam. And by those actions, manushyanam upakarodi, manushyanam lokaha, he becomes upakaraka. He serves the purpose of other human beings, the needy human beings. Afayat pashubhya tranodakam vindati, and then that he offers this tranayanodaka, the fodder and water to the animals. Vindati means lambhayati, makes them take it. Tena pashunam, that is how he becomes the upakaraka. He serves the purpose of the pashus or the animals. Yadasya graheju svapadaha vayamsija. Svapadaha marjaradeha. In his home, these other animals are also supported, like cats and dogs and whatever. Vayamsija. And also the birds. The crows come. They are also being offered. And other birds also come, like the pigeons and whatever. Pipilika devihisaha, apipilika abhyaha, that is being explained here. Pipilika devihisaha, including the ants, pipilika. So how all these are sustained by him? Well, he may make an effort also. He may actually place some grains for these birds, and he may throw some food at the dogs, and give some milk to the cats, and sow some refuse to these crows and whatever, and spread some little grains or flour for the ants. He may do all this. Either he does it deliberate. This is a deliberate action. These fellows get supported anyway whether you do that or not. You find all kinds of insects in your home and they get supported somehow or the other, but here he deliberately does it. Kana bali bhandakshalanadi upajivandi. Kana, all those little grains, food grains that are left over, deliberately. Bali, then you actually make an offering to them, or kanabali, tad bhagaruga bali. So usually when you make food, prepare food, you take out a little portion for these animals, for dogs or for cows and whatever. Bhandakshalanadi, washing the utensils, now whatever that means, so washing the utensils. I guess that way also, so cows will be drinking that water, I don't know what, bhandakshalanadi. And so, so by way of washing the utensils, you know. So that is how this little, I guess the ants, etc. So whatever is left over there, even on the soil, you know, so they generally partake of whatever little food is left over. Upajivanti, ashrayanti, this is how he gives ashraya to all this. As I said, when we were small, in our own neighborhood streets, you know, there used to be those stone receptacles, where all the refuse food, leftover food, was all deposited there and was eaten by cows and dogs and whatever. And there used to be special days when special food was prepared for these animals, and that is how the animals also were supported. Meaning that the human being also is aware that all of these is also existence, that all of these living beings also exist in the whole cosmos, and that Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, he looks upon himself as a part of this entire universal family. And so looks upon as his duty to also support them in his own way, recognizing that he is also supported by them, that he also is supported. Therefore, he experiences a sense of obligation, that I am enjoying many privileges in my life because I am supported by, or I am blessed by the devatas, by the pitrus, by the rishis. The rishis have dedicated their whole life to the pursuit of knowledge, because of which this whole store of knowledge is available to me, and I appreciate that. I am thankful for that. There are devatas in the form of sun and the moon and the earth and the water and the wind, and all of these devatas are incessantly working and serving the purpose of my life, and had they not been doing it, well, my life would not have been possible. The very same devatas also reside in my own body and are also responsible for the functioning of various sense organs of action and organs of perception, and that's the reason why the functioning of the body also is possible. So I'm aware of this. And therefore I feel, I know that I'm enjoying the privileges, that arises in me a sense of obligation, and that is how I happily do it. Of course, pitrus and the parents have given me this body, raised it, nurtured it, nourished it. And the ancestors are also directly or indirectly responsible for this body. And that is how I know that I am enjoying this privilege of having the body, and I am, you know, obliged to them, indebted to them. And I realize that even the animals like the birds, the creatures like birds and insects, and the dogs and cats and cows, all of these also have a certain role to play. Even the ants also, they are scavengers, clean away a lot of things. And that's how I realize that all of these also are playing a role in my life. So, this man establishes what we call a comfort level with the entire creation. This is what we call a comfort level, a harmony. So, I am comfortable with all these things being around me. And I receive sustenance from them. And I also, in my own way, offer sustenance to them. That is what we call a very beautiful, harmonious relationship of exchange between this man, or the human, this grahastha, and the rest of the creation. And this is how he serves the purpose of the creation. This is what is called yajna. Yajna asat karmanonyatra lokoyam karma bandhanaha. Lord Krishna says, when karma is performed in the spirit of yajna, then that karma becomes a releasing action. And when an action is performed in a spirit other than yajna, and when it is not, when it is other than yajna, meaning it is selfish action, then it becomes a binding action. Yajna shishtashana santaha muchyante sarva kilvishahi bhunjate te tvagham papaha ye pachanti atma karana. So those people who, after giving the due share of the yajna to all these creatures, so realize that all of them have shared in my life, that whatever I earn or whatever I make is not solely for myself, but then it's a cooperative effort. In short, we realize that in life there is a cooperative effort. The cooperation is received not only from the visible entities, but from all these invisible entities also, and therefore there is a share for all of them in my life. Then there is a consideration for all of them. There is an awareness that the world exists apart from me, and that there is an interchange. So, interaction rather with myself and the whole world, this interaction is understood, this interaction is accepted, and then their interaction also is supported. Thus this person lives an awareful life. Yajna shishtashana santaha muchyante sarva kilvishahi. So, of whatever I have earned, I also take out a share for all of these, and then partake the remaining ones. That is called amruta. And so, having made an offering to yajna, then whatever of those materials remain, that is called amrita, And that is what the Yajamana partakes. Muchande sarva kilvishahi. Then the person is released of all the sins. Because whatever I gain, or whatever I acquire, always brings with it some kind of blemishes. Because there is no action that is pure action. Sarvarambahe doshena bhumi nagmi rivavrata harikana. So what I do, however honest I may be, however pure I may be, there can never be anything that is pure in this creation. Therefore, every action is going to involve some blemish. Somebody may have been hurt. Somebody's right may have been deprived. Something would have happened, definitely. Even if you're building an ashram, definitely it happens. All the creatures are living there, you know, and therefore you are building something there, and so you're taking away, usurping the place of all those people. And what else could have been done there? Maybe the food would have been grown there, and you are converting this land from one to the other for your own purpose. And thus, you are depriving some creatures of some share that they would have had. In short, whenever we use the resources from this creation for our purposes, we are naturally depriving other beings of those resources. So I corner some resources for myself on the strength of whatever I have, because I have money and stuff like that. But still, regardless of what I do, I always trample upon the rights of some people, knowingly or unknowingly. This is recognized. That I cannot survive unless I hurt somebody in some way or the other. Thus, unfortunately, jivo jivasya jivanam. So one life form depends upon another life form. So my very dependence itself involves himsa or violence to some life forms. And that being the case, there must be prayaschitta, there must be a compensating act in order to neutralize the effect of this damage or hurt that I inadvertently create. And that is how kandani, peshani, chulli, udakumbhita, marjani, panchasuna, grahastasya. They say that grahastha has these five sins are incurred those days. That by the very life that we live, these five kinds of sins are incurred. Five kinds of himsa are done by us. Kandani, peshani, chulli. So kandani, khandanam. Peshani, peshanam. Chulli, meaning the fire. Udakumbhi, meaning the water part. Margani, the sweeping, the broom. So these are the five sources of himsa. When I clean the place with a broom, naturally some insects are going to be hurt. When I cook, some insects are going to be killed, because they are always there in wood and other things. And thus when I grind something, when I pound something, so when I do these things, there is going to be a hurt to the insect. Panchasuna grahastasya, that this grahastha is very life. In spite of the fact that life was so simple those days, today our life is much more complicated, much more demanding. Those days, man used to take a very small share from the nature for his sustenance. And today, every human being actually is taking so much share, because my needs are so many. Today I require all kinds of things, not only a sophisticated home, I require an air conditioner, I require all kinds of things I require. Electricity I require, and then special flooring, special air conditioning, special surfacing, all kinds of things I require. Special clothes, gardens and trees and whatever I require. So more and more requirements we have, and more share we are taking from the nature, and more we are depriving others of their share. More and more damage I am perpetrating in the nature by consuming more and more. And therefore, the one of the vrata is aparigraha, non-possession. So minimum of consumption. Because consumption means himsa. Of course, I cannot sustain my life unless there is some consumption on my part, because I must eat food and eat, drink water and whatever, and I must have clothes. But then also, anything more than what is absolutely necessary that I have amounts to himsa. I eat more food than what I should, himsa. I waste food, himsa. I store in my closet the clothes more than necessary, himsa. I amass all kinds of things around myself that I can do without, himsa. So at least an awareness is required. That's how himsa is involved in our day-to-day living. I may think that I am an ahimsaka, that I am a non-violent person, that I may be also. But my very living involves violence, that we should know. This is what the sages recognize. And that is how these fivefold yajnas were enjoined for a grihastha. Brahma yajna, Deva yajna, Pitru yajna, Guru yajna, Bhuta yajna. The five yajnas described in this Kandika were enjoined. In fact, a person was obliged to perform these yajnas in order to neutralize the effect of these sins, which are inadvertently performed. My very existence involves himsa. Then what to talk of my eating special food and doing special things for my own self? Naturally, it involves himsa. And therefore, this awareness on my part, and therefore, my also being always alert in remaining in harmony with the environment around myself by way of making an offering. That is how this the principle of the yajna, the how yajna or the sacrifice should be a part of one's life. And that is purifying. Lord Krishna thinks that the whole spirit of yajna or offering is purifying. The spirit of acquiring and enjoying is something that creates blemish. And in order to compensate the effect, the negative effect, I perform yajna, I give out, I offer, I make sacrifices. That is a purifying thing. And if that purification is not there, bhunjate te pratham papaha ye pachanti atma karanat, those people in whose life there is no space, no, others have no place in his life. His life is so preoccupied with his own self that nobody else has any room there. Bhunjate te pratham papaha. These are sinners, they are only eating sin. Papaha adham bhunjate. The sinners are only eating sin. Ye pachandi atmakarana. Those people who cook only for themselves, meaning those people whose life is dedicated merely for filling their own stomach, and that's it. They are, according to Lord Krishna, selfish people and also sinners. Not sinners in the sense of local law and stuff, so forth, but sinners in terms of what we call the spiritual law, or the moral law, let us say. The moral law or the ethics that actually conduct, govern the code of conduct in the whole creation, that we are not following that moral law, and that way we are committing a sin. All of this is said in the third chapter of Bhagavad Gita, where this very thing is pointed out by Lord Krishna, telling Arjuna how it is necessary that everybody should perform karma. And by karma is meant dharma, by karma is meant kartavya, how one should perform one's duty. And how do I know the duty? By the varna and ashrama. And that is how the creation of varna ashrama, so that a person knows what his or her duties are. And therefore, by following those injunctions of the Vedas, I automatically remain in harmony, because Vedas are going to require me to do all of this. And that's how, by following the injunctions or performing the enjoined duties, then the person automatically remains in harmony with the creation. This was the idea. That's how the whole varnashrama vyavastha was. Whatever was done later on with it is a different matter. But the reason why the whole vyavastha was is to enable this person to live a life in harmony with the environment, to remain in what we call an ecological balance, that I do not hurt the environment beyond what is necessary, that when I hurt the environment, that I deliberately perform an action to compensate that damage. No doubt that I will damage the environment, I will use the resources of the creation or the nature, no doubt about that. But then I create new resources. So all actions of puja and all of them involve that. The simple action of puja also involves purification or sanctification of all the various elements. And thus, when I just ring the bell or utter the mantras, then I am seeking to sanctify the sound, that is a space element. And also when I have this incense, etc., then this the air, and this is how different things are involved there in our puja, by which we are actually seeking to purify or seeking to contribute to the purification of all the five elements, because we know that we are polluting them. By our very existence, we are polluting the creation. We need not do all this dhumara business, you know, to pollute them further. But by our existence we are polluting. And that is how. To compensate for that pollution, these actions are. It's a very beautiful thing. How do I know what to do? That's why Vedas tell me. But who are they telling? That's why Varna and Ashrama Vyavastha. And that is how this man lives a life of harmony with the nature, which is nothing but God. And that is why pancha-yajna-pramuchyate. So, when five yajnas are performed, then the fivefold himsa that is done, inadvertently done, so one gets released from that. In short, one recognizes that in one's very conduct of oneself, that himsa or damage to the environment is involved, and that one should deliberately perform certain actions in order to compensate that damage by creating some positive effect also. Now on the page 319, Anandagiri says, Yathokta Homadivihi Devadin Prati Upakurvataha Grihinaha Vidya Pratibandha Sambhavat Tudupakaritva Vyavrutihi Tiyasimcha Yasmadivihi Yathokta Homadivihi Devadin Prati Upakurvataha Grihinaha. This Grihi meaning Grihastha, who by performs his Homa and the Yaga and all the Pindadana etc. by all the actions that are described in this Kandika. Devadin prati upakurvataha, that he serves the purpose of devatas and others that are described here. Grihinaha, of this grihastha, that when he is doing all of these, can there not be pratibandha? Vidyaya pratibandha sambhavat. Suppose that in him now the knowledge of Brahma, Brahma jnanam arises. So it was said earlier that when this person becomes jnani, meaning when he comes to know the true nature, his true self as Brahman, then he no more remains an animal for these devatas. Meaning he goes out of the fold or control of the devatas because he no more has abhimanam. The point is, as long as I have abhimana, as long as I have the sense of individuality, and I identify myself as so and so, as a Brahmana, Kshatriya, as father, and whatever I identify with, so that abhimanam, which is a product of the identification with upadhi, as long as that is there, so long of course I have this, I am obliged to perform the action. But when I recognize that I am the self, that is unconnected, asangohyayam purusha, that the self I am, that is unconnected to this upadhi, that I am not a brahmana, kshatriya, all of these are in fact the dharma of the body. So when I recognize that, I realize that I am not a brahmana, I am not so and so. Neva kinjit karomiti, I don't perform any action. So when that knowledge takes place, no more does he feel a sense of obligation to anybody. And therefore, he no more has tasya karyam na vidyate. Then there remains nothing to be done for him. And so, nachasya sarvabhuteshu kasya artha vyapasraya, he does not depend upon any living being or any being in the creation. He is not dependent upon them for his existence. And that being the case, he no more has any sense of obligation. Therefore, he goes out of the fold of these fellows. That means Brahma Vidya is actually an obstacle to this relationship of pratyupakara. That is what is said here. So, pratyupakurvataha grihinaha vidyaya pratibandha sambhavat. That if the knowledge Brahma Vidya takes place, Brahma Vidya itself becomes pratibandha, becomes an obstacle to his very sense of duty, because sense of duty can be there only as long as there is a sense of individuality. And when that goes away by Brahma Vidya, then Brahma Vidya becomes an obstacle to his performance of the duty. And then this devata naturally will be unhappy. Tat upakaritva vyavrutihi, he will no more remain an upakari for them. Man, he becomes wise. Iti asinkyah. So, what about that? So, this is being said, yes, Mahalati. Yasmat ayam etani karmani kurvan upakarote devadibhyah tasmat yathahavai loke svayalokaya स्वस्मै देहाय अरिष्टिम् अविनाशम् स्वत्वभाव अप्रच्युतिम् इच्छेद् स्वत्वभाव प्रच्युति भयात् पोषण रक्षणादिभिः सर्वतः परिपालये एवं ह एवं विदे सर्वभूत भोग्योहम् अनेन प्रकारेण मया अवश्यं वृणीवत् प्रतिकर्तव्यम् इत्येवम् आत्मानं परिकल्पितवते सर्वाणि भूतानि देवादीनि यथोक्तानि अरिष्टिम् अविनाशमिच्छन्ति।